you see, the theme that we talked about, which has been the cornerstone of my work for almost 20 years, you know, and again, the idea of using a living system as a surrogate or a model for making advanced materials. We discussed the fact that everything that we built historically from the 50s and earlier, 40s and earlier, was all from the six simple physics machines, and that with the advent of the electronics age, everything that we built came from these five fundamental components, and that you know, the hypothesis that I work from and that I believe in is that molecules are themselves unit operators that have an inherent level of function, and this function allows you to engage in making systems that are far more complex than you had before. Because we have 11 components, we have the opportunity to be able to have access to many hundreds of individual components. So if you look at the molecules that are up here, what you see is you have active filters, you have motors and chemical factories, you have valves that open and close based upon environmental stimulus, you have transducers, you have pumps, you have all these little pieces that are molecules. And so all of these molecules, by and large, a large number of them, reside in membranes. They reside in the walls of those cells, because those membranes provide the stability that allow them to not fall apart. And the reason being is that these molecules have different regions of hydrophobicity. There's usually a region that on one side that's hydrophilic, there's a middle band which is hydrophobic, and then there's another band, there's another band which is hydrophilic. And so collectively, they are unstable in water and outside the membranes. And what the end result is that we're able to take peptides now, combine them with monomers to create a new classes of monomers that have different levels of functionality. So now we're going to have the ability to build materials that, where we normally talk about the function of materials in terms of its intrinsic strength, its transparency, its flexibility, its conductivity, all these normal properties that are intrinsic to the material. We're now adding a tailored biological function as an intrinsic property of the material. So we've expanded the color wheel of properties for these chemicals. So this is where it opens up the door for doing some really novel things. So we came up with this concept of 4D printing. But the idea is that can we do functional architecture that is distributed in space and location and time and assemble these using materials that have different biological properties. So if you think about normal 3D printing, is that what you find is that it's usually a single material. And it's usually a plastic or a ceramic or a metal, and it's basically like the wood of a tree. It gives you architecture. It gives you spatial architecture. People who do regenerative medicine talk. But with the electronics, what we're doing is we have a project in which we're making next generation biologically sensored neural probes in high densities. And so what we do is we make neuronal probes that are flexible in structure, and that we put biological molecules incorporated as a junction to make biological transistors. These transistors are FETs. They respond to specific chemicals, dopamine and some others that are found inside the brain. To develop, looking at brain function. And so we're working on doing this, and I'm working in partnership with an industrial partner called Neuralinks and developing this technology to make ultra-high density neuronal probes for treatment of Parkinson's disease and some other ailments that are associated with it. And the wonderful thing about it is, of course, we're using a printing technology for doing this. We can tailor the using, or we intend to with that other machine, that 5-axis machine, to tail them conformally in multiple dimensions so that we can fit them exactly to the patient that you want to and make it just in time. Again, the idea of making personalized medicine that is tailored specifically for the individual patient. We're also making flexible sensors and flexible transducers with this technology. Here you see one of my graduate students demonstrating these sensors. These are the radio sensors, which measure electrolytes. Again, they're just printed on top of this on the surface, and they provide a level of doing multi-analyte sensing. So what we're doing is trying to measure a bunch of physiological properties from those sensors on the surface. And the goal here is to make smart band-aids, right? So you go to the doctor and you slap one on, and all of a sudden you can start monitoring and assessing a bunch of tests that you would normally have to go to and take a blood draw and send to a clinic, but you can do it locally. The neat thing about it is that we're finding it is that they're extraordinarily sensitive, and we can measure many things. What we're doing is we're using carbon nanotube arrays, an idea that I had for incorporating them. That previously people couldn't use nanotube arrays because they were designing them differently. What they do is they have two electrodes and they try and put a nanotube between those two electrodes, and there's no way to manufacture that. And so what we've done is we put an array of them, then we use information processing to extract out the signal from the array. So that way you can make it low-cost manufacturing versus something that requires a PhD, 4 days, and 50 samples to find one that works. Again, it's a transition from science to technology, which is really where the rubber meets the road, right? It's the idea of taking the opportunity to take what we know and translate it to be meaningful versus doing things and showing what's possible. Now, among the other things that we're doing with it, also, we also put temperature sensors and heaters on. And so we can dynamically control the localized temperature on the surface. We can heat things. So if you want to do sensing, you want to cause the little area in your body to sweat. So you can get the things. We can heat the local area and get the area to start releasing fluids that allow you to assess and sense. So we've been working on this only for about a year. And we've already developed the technology for rapidly moving it forward. Again, it's the white space that we talked about earlier. It's a space that converges material science with electrical engineering applied to applications that are orthogonal to the areas. So you think about taking something where cells have all these different molecules in their cell membrane. And what we're doing is we're taking these, making artificial systems, with the end result is that we're assembling them all within our own engineered structures. You all there? Okay. So what we're doing is, to do this, we're making machines that use stereolithography. Actually, I'm having the second prototype of the machine actually being built here in Kochi by Holmark. And what we're doing here is we designed the first machines in-house, but essentially a controlled light source that puts out different colors of light, and we're using a DLP chip like you would find on advanced projectors. So we're projecting, the idea is to project an image of different colors of light and to enable the polymerization of only those polymers that polymerize with that color of light in that position. Now, the big challenge is why we're having Holmark work with us is that the energy of each color of photon is different, right? E is equal to h nu. We all remember that from physics 101, right? And the fact is that the blue light has, each photon has a lot more energy than the red light does. which means you have to change the amount of photon flux to have a coordinated exposure time to the, get the all the material to polymerize at the right time. And otherwise, what we find is that when we do the testing, is that you'll have something that's red light that requires a polymerization time of a minute, whereas the polymerization time for the blue would be 5 seconds. And so what we need to do is be able to dynamically control the intensity of the light in addition to the color of the light, so that we can make structures with the integrity that we want to have. So here what you're looking at is a series of arbitrary images that we made using different levels of exposures. We're able to get a minimum resolution of about 200 microns. We have another machine which I showed you in the first slide, a nanoscribe on order, which supposedly will give us 200 nanometers of resolution. But, so we get a 200 micron resolution. We're able to make some pretty interesting features and structures using this technology. But here what you see is is one of the hydrogels that was made with green light. So it's using the material that was engineered by Stella and shows that we're able to get it to polymerize in green light. The red light ones are still a challenge. The exposure times are too long. You end up with materials that you make it and they don't fully cure, and so they drift, they're too small, they don't maintain the dimensional stability. So we're still working that problem. But we were able to, they're all those smart geniuses who do everything. And this has been a highlight of my life, coming here and doing this. And I want you to know all of it becomes a juggling match to find the optimum solution.
One
thing
that
you also
use in this
for hydrogel. And then they place cells in an organized structure with the idea of trying to replicate the organ. The problem that they have is that oftentimes the extracellular matrix doesn't develop properly, so the organ isn't really there. So people have done that to make artificial trachea, right? And they don't last very long, and there's problems associated. It's still, we're exploring. People are exploring the space that they're looking to. But we have actually a bioplotter for printing and positioning individual cells in space within a hydrogel. So what they do is they create a hydrogel, and they create the hydrogel and deposit the cells. So the hydrogel acts as physical containment with the idea that on moral compass. If you want to do something, for instance, for replacing the skin using fish scale collagen. And what they're doing is an extension, I'm sure, of the work that's already been approved and being used in Asia. In Asia, they pioneered the idea of using fish scales. In Japan, I believe, in Hong Kong, of using fish scales. They're doing them on patients to replace the corneas, for cornea repair. So you have somebody who's used the core technology for an application that's been approved and shown to be efficacious for a very, very sensitive environment. You're going to be using it for wound healing, and you say, well, the wound is probably equivalent or not as sensitive as using it in the eye. And they've shown that there's really good response with it. Let's try it on here, and there's no real side effects associated with it. The side effects you have with using eye is it becomes cloudy, and you have to cut it that way and remove it. So for this, optical transparency is not an issue. As long as it's sterilized, I think that they weigh the fact that it's been used in another application.